7, the atom was the atom. Different atoms make up different things. Different atoms look different and maybe are different sizes, but the atom itself can't get any smaller than the atom. There's nothing inside the atom. There's no protons, neutrons, and electrons. The atom is like a billiard ball. Remember, if you take the chemistry, the Dalton solid sphere model of the atom. The atom is like a marble or a billiard ball. They may be different, but there's nothing that makes it up. It's as small as it gets. Enter Thomson, J.J. Thomson, in 1897, when he discovered the electron. We have a picture of a TV up here because he used something that's in one of the old style TVs in order to discover this electron. It's called a cathode ray tube. A cathode ray tube looks something like this. Inside this evacuated glass tube, it's all the air is sucked out of it. Inside this evacuated glass tube, you have a couple of electrodes. This electrode would be, what's the charge on that one? What is it? No. It's negative because the negative end of the battery, the negative end of the power supply, is closest to that. So that becomes a negative end of a negative terminal here. We also have a positive terminal here. We call the negative terminal, and this might get a little bit confusing to take the chemistry. We call this negative terminal the cathode. Confusing myself there. The cathode, and we would call this the anode. Prior to 1897, and in 1897 when Thomson discovered the electron, many people had seen this mysterious greenish glow coming from the cathode, going to the anode, but going right through the anode because we've got a hole in there, and then striking the screen over here. People have seen that for maybe 40 years, but it wasn't until 1897 that Thomson explained what that was. Prior to that, people just called it cathode rays. Cathode rays because there's something, there's some kind of ray, some kind of, maybe it's light, maybe it's some kind of particle, we're not really sure. Some kind of ray leaving the cathode going towards the anode. Cathode rays. But Thomson wants to find out more about these cathode rays. He wants to determine exactly what makes them up. He's not trying to discover the electron. He's trying to see what makes up these cathode rays. So he introduces over here on the right-hand side a magnetic field. That magnetic field, as you know, will cause us knowing that these are negatively charged particles, we know that it will cause the particles by the Hand Wolf reflection to be deflected downwards in a circular path. So the path of these particles is going to end up looking something like this. Now, this wasn't rocket science. We knew prior to 1897 about electric charge. We knew how electric charges behaved in magnetic fields. We knew that if magnetic fields caused something to be deflected in this direction, then that something must be negatively charged things. Now, that doesn't tell us that we've got electrons. It just told Thomson at this point that we have negatively charged particles. It's not electromagnetic radiation. Rather, it's negatively charged particles. Okay? We're getting there, but we still haven't discovered the electron yet. Thomson says, you know what? That's not enough for me. Hey, I want to calculate something. I want to determine some of the properties of these negatively charged particles. Like how heavy are they? What's the charge of these negatively charged particles? And so on. So he does a bit of an analysis that we've done before. He says Fc is equal to Fm. These charged particles are going in a circle in a magnetic field. Again, this isn't groundbreaking science at this point. Even 120 years ago, this isn't groundbreaking science. We knew that negatively charged particles would be deflected in this direction in a magnetic field. We could know they were electrons, that's all. Because mv squared over r is equal to qdv. V's cancel. mv over r equals q times v. And he says, look, I know what the value of v is. Sorry, I know what the value value of R is. I know what the value of R is because I can take a look at where they hit the screen. This screen, by the way, is painted with a phosphorescent coating that glows when these beams strike it. That's why the older style TVs actually create the image that they do. It's beams of electrons hitting the backside of this glass, the screen, that's painted with this phosphorescent coating, which causes it to glow when beams of electrons hit it. So he knows exactly where these beams hit, and from that he can measure the radius of the path. He can also determine the magnetic field strength, because he introduced the magnetic field strength, so he can make the magnetic field strength whatever he wants. But what he doesn't know is M. He doesn't know the mass of these negatively charged particles. He also doesn't know how fast they're moving, and he also doesn't know the charge of these negatively charged particles. So he's got five variables. He knows two of them, and he doesn't know three of them. That doesn't seem to me much use. He hasn't really learned anything about these negatively charged particles in terms of quantitatively, at least, only that they're negatively charged. Okay, at least not yet. So here's what he does. He introduces another section, another, we'll call it a chamber of this cathode ray tube, trying to determine something else. He introduces magnetic field right here, which will once again cause these particles to be deflected downwards, unless we also have an electric field caused by these charged parallel plates. There would be a magnetic force downward, and there would be an electric force on these negatively charged particles upward. Some of these particles will be going too fast or too slow. If they're going too fast, then the magnetic force will be stronger than the electric force, and the particles are going to be deflected downwards. If they're going too slow, the particles are going to be deflected upwards because the magnetic force isn't strong enough. But if they're going at just the right speed, the Goldilocks speed, they're going at just the right speed, then they're going to go through there undeflected because Fe will be equal to Fm. The electric force upward will be equal to the magnetic force downward. Now, the electric force is Q times the electric field. The magnetic force is QEB. Q's cancel. Thompson rearranges this to solve for speed, E over V. He knows the electric field strength. Right? He knows this value for the electric field. He introduced it. He can make it whatever he wants. He knows the value of magnetic field because, once again, he introduced it. He can make it whatever he wants. He solves for the speed, not the speed of all the particles, but the speed of the ones that went straight through. Right? The ones that went up, the ones that went down, who cares about those? The ones that went straight through, he knows how fast they're moving. And he knows how fast they're moving when they enter this purple chamber over here. So now, he's got another variable. Now he knows what V is as well. So V becomes 3. Becomes a norm, not an unknown. Becomes a given. Now that he's solved for the speed of these undeflected particles. Now he knows 3 out of the 5 instead of 2 out of the 5. So the balance has shifted. Okay, the tipping point has been reached. He knows more than half the variables. He only is missing 2 variables. Now, he'd still like to be able to calculate Q or M, and he can't do that without knowing 4 variables. But we're in a much better position now. If somebody came to this door, knocked on this door right now in the classroom, and said to Isaac, how old are you? Isaac, what would you say? No, you wouldn't say that, because you were going to sleep, going to cluster or something like that all over there, right? You wouldn't say that. Isaac would say, I'm not talking to strangers. That's what he would say, Isaac. Okay? And the person would say, like, oh, come on. And like, Mr. Dickey, how old are you? And I'm like, I'm not talking to strangers. But then we feel sorry for the person. And we say, you know what? Okay, we'll tell you that Mr. Dickey is 2.5 times older than Isaac. We'll give you the ratio of my age to Isaac's age, right? And the person says, okay, I wanted to know how old Isaac was, I wanted to know how old you were, I don't know how old either one of you are, but I know more than I came with, right? I know that Mr. Dickey is 2.5 times older than Isaac. Make sense? It's not what we wanted, but it's better than what he had when he knocked on the door, right? So Thompson does something similar here. He says, look, I want M, and I want Q, and I don't know what either one of them is, and I can't figure out a way to find M or Q, but what I can do is find a ratio of Q to M. So he rearranges it. M goes over by dividing, B goes over to the other side by dividing, and I end up getting Q over M is equal to V over V times R. Again, we want more. We want Q and we want M. And we know what Q and M are now, right? A guy named Milliken performed an experiment later on to determine the value of Q. We'll talk about that one on Monday, actually. But for now, Thompson's satisfied that he at least knows the ratio of charge and mass. Just like that person that knocked on the door is satisfied they at least know the ratio of my age to Isaac's age. That ratio, by the way, worked out to be, and you don't need to memorize this number, 1.76 times 10 to the 11 coulombs per kilogram. Now, that's significant. That's really significant, actually. That's significant because it was so big. In fact, it's bigger than any other charge to mass ratio ever measured for anything. So Thompson measures the charge to mass ratio. Lots of other people may measure the charge to mass ratio of some other things. And this is the biggest one ever measured. Why is that a big deal? Yeah? Okay. If the charge to mass ratio is bigger than the charge to mass ratio of anything else ever measured, then that means the mass is smaller than the mass of anything else ever measured, including the mass of lots of atoms. If you've got a mass here now that is smaller than the mass of atoms, then you must have negatively charged particles. Right? You already knew they were negatively charged particles. You must have negatively charged particles that are smaller than atoms. And there is the discovery of the electron, the subatomic nature of them, right? Q over M is big, M is small, smaller than atoms, therefore we must have subatomic particles. The existence of little who's inside a speck of dust, right? And proof for it. Does that make sense? Now, this led to a model of the atom that some people call the plum pudding model of the atom, some people call the chocolate chip cookie dough model of the atom, some people call it the raisin bun model of the atom. It boils down to this. The atom is a sea of positive charge. Okay? It's like a harbor full of water that is positively charged. The water is the sea of positive charge. Floating around in that sea of positive charge might be some sailboats. Okay? Or floating around in the chocolate chip cookie dough or chocolate chips, or floating around inside the bun is a bunch of little raisins. I don't know what plum pudding actually looks like, so I can't describe that one. Floating around in the sea of positive charge, you'll be able to a bunch of little negatively charged subatomic particles called electrons. Now, this model of the atom isn't close to the current model of the atom that we accept, but it's at least an acknowledgement. It's revolutionary because it's at least an acknowledgement that there's something smaller than the atom, that there's subatomic. Does that make sense? Okay, I'm going to go back to this slide for just a second here. I'm going to name these. These are my names, okay, not official names. So don't look for them in a book somewhere, or don't look for them next year if you take physics in university. I'm just going to name them so that when we're talking about them, as we're doing problems, we're talking the same language. It doesn't really matter what they're called, as long as we all have to speak the same language. I'm going to call this third chamber over here the main chamber. The main chamber. This is where the cathode rays, or as we now know them, the electrons, get deflected in this magnetic field. The main chamber, we say FC is equal to FM. This middle chamber, this middle section right here, we're going to call, and this is actually a fairly commonly used name, this isn't my term for this middle one, we're going to call this the velocity selection chamber, or the velocity selector. The velocity selection chamber, or the velocity selector, because it selects a velocity to go through, to go straight through. All the other velocities kind of get filtered out. Now, there is an area over here that we could analyze. We don't do it that often, but we could. We'll call this one over here on the left-hand side the acceleration chamber. Because really what's happening here is these cathode rays, or these, as we now know them to be electrons, accelerate from rest from the cathode to a certain speed at the anode. I think we'd analyze it if we ever had to do that. I think you'd analyze it if you've got these beams of electrons, beams of negatively charged particles, or cathode rays, or beams of electrons, accelerating from rest of the cathode towards the anode. Yeah. Exactly. Conservation of energy, charged particles speeding up. It's like a car going down the hill. We would say Q times VI, that's potential, not speed. Q times VI is equal to 1 half of MV half squared. That's speed. Now, why didn't Thompson just do that? Why did he introduce this middle chamber, this velocity selector, this velocity selection chamber? Why couldn't he just find speed here and put it in there? Anybody? Yeah. He didn't know what Q or M was. Right? He didn't know what Q or M was. Plus, that assumes 100% efficient energy transformation, right? So if it's not going 100%, well, then they're not actually going to be going that speed. And the reality is, some of them would be going that maximum speed, some of them would be going slower, and which ones are which? This allowed them, this velocity selection chamber allowed them to filter out all but one speed. So he knows exactly how fast, not all the electrons are going, he knows exactly how fast the ones that are going straight through entering this main chamber. But be prepared for this. Okay? We may have to do an acceleration chamber type problem where we say QV equals 1F MV squared, but we've done those before. Okay, we may have to do a main chamber problem where we say FC is equal to FM. But you know what? We've done those before too, just haven't called it the main chamber of a cathode. We may have to do a velocity selection chamber problem. We haven't quite done that, but we've done FE and FM, just not really together. Or we may have to combine a couple. We may have to find the speed from the velocity selection chamber to sub into the main chamber. Does that make sense? So, besides the mathematics, besides the problems, which you're going to solve in just a moment here, besides that, what's the big takeaway from this? It's like a 3 or 4 word answer. Discovery of the electron. The discovery of the electron. And essentially, how did he conclude that he's discovered the electron, the subatomic negatively charged particle? Because he calculated the charge and mass ratio. And the charge and mass ratio is so like so big, so large. The mass had to be so small, smaller than anything else ever measured. Therefore, it must have been subatomic. All right? Let's take a look at an example here involving some mathematics. It says electrons are accelerated from rest to a potential difference of 2300 volts within a cathode ray tube. So from the cathode to the anode in a cathode ray tube, determine the maximum speed of the electron. Which chamber of the cathode ray tube is this? When electrons are accelerated from rest to a certain speed. Is this the acceleration chamber? Is this the velocity selection chamber? Or is this the main chamber? It is the acceleration chamber, right. Now, when you're solving a cathode tube problem, there's kind of an extra step that there is to solving most problems. Because here, you have to identify, usually you identify what's the concept of doing it, right? And then you go with it. And here you got to identify, okay, what's the concept that you're dealing with? It's the cathode tube. Okay, what's the sub-concept I'm dealing with? oh, it's the acceleration chamber of the catheter tube. So even once you've identified that it's a catheter tube problem, you've got to identify what part of the catheter tube it is. This is the acceleration chamber. So we're going to say, as Julia said, suggested we try a few minutes ago, EI is equal to EF. The initial energy is potential. It starts from rest. It would be like a car at the top of the hill, right? Car at rest at the top of the hill. That car would have potential energy, MGH. But this time, it's not gravitational potential energy. It's electric potential. So we just replace MGH with QV. And we're back in unit two. Okay, think of it as the car going down the hill. Picture the car going down the hill. Even if you want to, write down MGH. Just replace it with QV. Now, what kind of energy does the car have when it's reached the bottom of the hill? Or what kind of energy does the electron have when it's reached the anode? It's got kinetic energy. So we'll sub in 1F mv squared for EF. The charge of the electron is 1.60 times 10 to minus 19 coulombs. We know this, right? Thompson didn't know this. So Thompson wouldn't have been able to do this because he didn't know the charge. But we know it. And we know the potential difference is 2.30 times 10 to 3 volts. The mass of the electron, we know this to be 9.11 times 10 to minus 31. Thompson didn't know this. So he wouldn't have been able to do this again. And we're going to solve for Vf, the final speed, at least the maximum possible final speed. Not all of the electrons are moving that fast, because it's not always 100% efficient energy transformation. Okay, let's calculate this here. The left-hand side, 1.6 times 10 to minus 19 times 2.3 times 10 to the 3. Times it by 2. Divide it by 9.11. Do the EE button here, right? Because you start dividing by an exponent, and you're not using the EE button. You better make sure you're using brackets. It's easier to do this one. Let's go read that. And we end up with a speed of 2.84 times 10 to the 7. Yep. That's really, really fast. If it's much faster than that, you've made a mistake. This is realistic, although it's high, because it's less than 3 times MV meters per second. If it's bigger than that, then something's wrong. Okay, let's take a look at another quick example here. This one says a charged particle passes undeflected through perpendicular electric and magnetic fields. Determine the speed of the charged particle. It's a catheter tube problem. It doesn't say that, but it is a catheter tube problem. Or at least it's like a section of a catheter tube, even if it is in some other context, we can treat it that way. Which chamber or section of the catheter tube would this be? Yep. The velocity selection chamber. Good. Now, Bruce, what leads you to that? What leads you to that conclusion that it's a velocity selection chamber? Good. It passes undeflected. That's a key word there, right? In the acceleration chamber, it's not deflected either, but you wouldn't see that term undeflected in the acceleration chamber. In the main chamber, it certainly is not undeflected because it goes in a circle. In the velocity selection chamber, it goes undeflected. So it leads me to that conclusion. Now, there's something else that can lead me to the velocity selection chamber as well. What is it? You don't need the other, right? If you catch the word undeflected, that's good. You know what it is, right? If you don't catch that word undeflected, what else can lead you to that conclusion? Yep. Good, Harrison. Electric and magnetic field. Okay, in the acceleration chamber, you just have an electric field or a potential difference causing the electrons to accelerate. In the main chamber, you just have a magnetic field. It's only in the velocity selection chamber, you have both. So either one of those can lead me to the conclusion that it is a velocity selection chamber question. In that, we're going to say Fe, the electric force, equals Fm, the magnetic force. The upward electric force equals Fm, the downward magnetic force. Qe is equal to QVD. these, they're sort of huge cancer, which means it doesn't really matter how fast these, what the charge of these particles are, they're still going to be under threat. Solve for V. Not the velocity, but the speed, even though we call it the velocity section, so we're solving for speed here. It's E over V. The electric field is 6,000 newtons per coulomb, and the magnetic field is 7.00 × 10⁻³ Tesla. Let's figure out what that is. (6,000)÷7 × 10⁻³ gives me 8.57 × 10⁵. So this is better than what we just did. Right? We just did in example number one, where we found the maximum possible speed, not how fast they're actually moving, but how fast they could be moving. Here we found the actual speed of the electrons that make it through under threat. Some of them might be going faster, some may be going slower, but those ones don't make it straight through if they're going too fast or too slow. So we don't really care about those. We just care about these ones. We know exactly how fast they're going. Now they enter the main chamber. And we could solve for Q over M if we had done that. One more, and then I'm going to be done. So determine the charge of mass ratio of a particle that's deflected in an arc of radius 9.5 × 10⁻² in a cathode ring tube. The particle's moving at this speed. We're making it through at 0.710. What chamber is this? This is the main chamber. Harrison would tell me that this is just a magnetic field, so therefore it's the main chamber. Okay. Bruce might tell me that it's deflected in an arc, so therefore it's the main chamber. So a couple different ways of determining that it's the main chamber. Now, you may or may not be given this velocity. If you're not given this velocity, find it. Like we just did in example number two. If you are given this speed or velocity, great, use it. For the main chamber, we say Fc is equal to Fn. We say mv squared over r equals qvb. And just like we did back in our 2 units ago, magnetism cancels the v's. The mv over r equals q times b. Now we're solving for q over m. So the m goes down by dividing, and then the b also goes down by dividing. So I end up with v over b times r equals q over m, or q over m is equal to v over b. Speed is 3.6 × 10⁶. Magnetic field is 0.710 times the radius of the path, 9.5 × 10⁻². That doesn't even say the units there. It should say meters. Let's figure out what this is. There's some brackets on the bottom. 0.71 times 9.5 × 10⁻². Is that right? 5.34 × 10⁻¹⁴, 5, 6, 7. Hey, that seems reasonable to me. You know why it seems reasonable to me? Because it's smaller than 1.76 × 10⁻¹, which we know is going to be the biggest charge to mass ratio that we're going to find, right? You're not going to get bigger than the charge to mass ratio of the electron. Now, I told you you don't have to memorize the charge to mass ratio of the electron, but it's one of those things, like a lot of things, I tell you that, hey, you don't need to memorize it, but sometimes it's helpful if you remember it, because you can check to see if something is reasonable based on it. If I had the charge end of mass already of this particle, what would be the easiest way of finding the charge mass ratio? Just divide them. Right? If I want to find the charge to mass ratio, and I know charge and I know mass, just divide it. But remember that Thompson didn't know charge or mass, so he had to find the ratio by using V over V times R. All right? All right. You're going to have a chance to do some work here now. Worksheet number 22. If you think we'll get that worksheet, actually on the screen now, and be walking around, asking questions. Be thinking, remember, A, how do you know this is a cathode rate problem? And B, which section or chamber of the cathode rate tube is it? And how do I know?